So good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the Electronic Music Forum 2014. On behalf of the Electronic Music Lab at NUS, I'm very glad to welcome all of you here, and especially glad to welcome such an illustrious panel that we have today, and our moderator, Emily, who is going to lead this discussion on how we're going to grow the whole electronic music scene in Singapore. That sound is not one of our artists, that sound is construction work going on side. Outside, I know it's easy to see mistaken. You can see Pete straight away say sample it. Right? I know many of you were thinking of, I could use that for a breakdown. So we are among friends, so feel free, relax. If anybody needs to take an oxygen break, go ahead. Don't take it personally. But I'm very happy to have Emily to moderate this forum, because Emily has not only been an alumni of Electronic Music Lab and very faithfully helping with many of the things that we do, especially our marketing. She is also the blogger for Music Biz in Asia, where she actually interviews many of the top movers and shakers in the music industry and how the business grows in Asia. So she also is, in her own right, a songwriter with compositions that have been already licensed to soundtracks, and she also has produce her own photo, audio, video series, which is, if you don't know what that means, you must go to www.immeeting.sg. It's all on the Facebook link. So then it just leaves me to thank Emily and to hand the mic over to her.
Very big panel, a very interesting and illustrious panel as well. Okay, so we have 2 hours. So for the 2 hours of asking Ben, well, what can we do? What are we going to talk about for 2 hours, right? So and firstly, let me just introduce the flow. We will go one by one. Introduce yourself. I mean, it's quite an informal session anyway. Talk a little bit about what kind of music you do. What are your influences? And also we have also prepared one of the tracks to be placed to be shared. Ultimately what we want to instill here is a spirit of sharing, right? And a spirit of collaboration. Which is something we probably need to talk about later when we talk about growing the electronic music scene here. After the introductions, then we'll go into maybe elaborating each of you in your own space, in your own, to your own audience. What you have done to promote yourself or your own music, whether you are an artist yourself or a producer, or whether you run a label or you are under a label like Sion Chair. What have you done? What do you think has worked for you? And so that others can also learn from you. I guess in the context of growing the music, electric music scene. Yesterday I just happened to come across this this paper by NAC. It's about growing the music scene in Singapore. And I thought maybe it would be to clarify, I'm not from the NAC. But I thought this would be a very good framework towards our discussion today. It includes, under the vision and the recommendations, it's stated here that for there to be a music scene all Singaporeans are proud to own and participate in, we need to seek artistic growth, grow the appetite for Singapore music, and develop market intermediaries as champions for the sector. Well, what it means will be like intermediaries championing discovery, development, production, and promotion of music talents. So, well, we all really could just bear that in mind while we were discussing about how to grow the electronic music scene in Singapore. Okay, then without further ado, let me just introduce our first person on the panel. On my right, we have Felix Wu from Trans Republic. So let's give a welcome to Felix.
Myself, Yeah.
So what's the current music project that you're working on now?
Current music project I'm working on now is probably another mix from another artist called Trans Eye. And also, of course, I'm working on our own music. And I'm trying to do a bit different stuff, like I'm trying to infuse other types of musical elements, like from different genres into the genre that I like, trance music, and try to create something like just the one that I just heard we're hearing now. So other than that, of course, I have other side projects, like also with my friend. She's a singer-songwriter for Chinese music. So I occasionally would ask her and she'll pass me the lyrics and then we'll work on that and work on the Chinese song as well. Yeah.
So we're going to feature one of your tracks. So maybe before we play the track itself, maybe you could share with us what's the track about, how did it happen, you know, and what was it like producing it? Maybe you can introduce the title of the track first.
Okay, the title of the track is called Faith and Hope. And pretty much it's kind of like, there are a lot of like artists that, you know, they are putting out their tracks for collaboration or remixes. And so I happened to chance on this one on the site. And I was listening to it and I just felt that I have an idea. The title gave me some inspiration and also the way he does it. So I decided maybe I want to do it differently. So I decided to just say, I want to participate and try to remix the song. That's how it came about. Experimental music. started out as when they recruited me, I was kind of, I think I was like the fifth or the sixth member of the group. So when they asked me to join them, I was kind of just like a student there. And I just joined because I like just playing music with them. And then after, when they start leaving, there was a chance. There was a chance that Trans Republic might close down. Because like, I think if you follow the history from previous times, Frontal, during the TN days, where there's Frontal and Radiant Crew, and all the other genres, and all these collectives, was doing very good work in promoting the, all these underground genres of music. You know, and eventually the same thing happens, and then it closed down. Move on. So I just felt
bad
that if I nobody does it, then it would just close down. So I decided to get on. So as to how I build it up, I guess there's
So you're mainly on Facebook? Or are you on using
Facebook? Right now, I guess it's mainly Facebook, I guess. Because previously, there was a forum, like a forum where you register your name, you know, and all that, and you post under a name and all that stuff. But I think that site, that type of the type of platform is not too popular these days, I think. So I think that's why I think we opted for Facebook now.
And how do you actually pull that?
I think that'll be summarized under one word, time. Time, yeah. I think it takes time for a community to grow, and I think my philosophy is just to add 1% at a time. So if I meet someone in we have an event or a gig or some sort of meeting, then I think if people know me, I will go out and talk to people. I'm like, hey, my name is Felix, you know, we are trying to figure out what we do and get them to try to make friends with them, and if they like what we are doing, then they will kind of join about me in the community itself. So that's, I guess, the philosophy would be 1% at a time.
Slow and steady approach.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, because I feel that I'm not here to create I have an aim. My aim is to recruit 1,000 members in 1 year. Take my time. I think it should be grown organically.
Is it a one-man show? Are you a one-man show?
It used to be, but now I'm not really. At least I think now I've developed it.
That's great.
So, yeah.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Felix. We move on to the next panelist. That'll be Jada. Jada is a graduate from the 2012 FFF Go DJ Bootcamp, and she is featured under FIDA, if I get it correct, an independent electronic music label based in Singapore. So maybe you can tell us a little bit more about yourself, your music influences, and also a little bit about the label, as in is it your own label, or how did it come about?
Well, basically, I graduated from the FFF Girl DJ Bootcamp. So I think you know my mentor is actually Chi. So she is one of my major influences back then. And
to our next panelist, and that would be
Farah.
Yeah. Yes. Well, Farah, you are not a replacement. We are very happy to have you aboard. Farah, just to introduce her, she's actually from Darker Than Wax. And her interests, very interesting. She's lie in digital marketing, social media, music communication, and writing. So, and maybe you can talk a little bit about your the PR work that you have done so far, and how does these skills that you have helped you as a a musician, as an artist yourself, and also maybe talk a little bit more about Darker Than Wax as well. I realize that there are so many people who own independent labels here or record labels. So I'm sure the audience would want to know, how do you actually run that?
So I don't actually write or own Darker Than Wax. It's actually founded by two other artists, like local artists called Costa Nostra. I guess we were friends a couple of years ago. I went out to their parties, got to know them as friends, and then I really resonated with the music that they were playing and producing as well, and the artists that they had on board back then. So they were like, yeah, since you have PR, you have experience in PR, that's why you don't have a job, by the way. So they were like, we can definitely grow in that aspect. So they got me in, and then, one of the founders control Facebook, Twitter, and SoundCloud, and he does A&R. I think it's his he likes to be in charge of this kind of thing. So for me, I'm I oversee everything, and I'm like, I think we should have an Instagram, we should contact potential artists on SoundCloud, So yeah, have a bit of diversity in our music. So Darker Than Wax actually started with playing a lot of house, boogie, and 4/4 stuff, So then when I got in, I was like, there's this whole new sound that we should explore, and that's a trending sound that people would like to get on, and it's good that we can educate the Singaporean crowd as well, with the new stuff that's coming out and trending. So yeah, I guess I'm more of I like to notice consumer trends, because that's part of my job as well. So I look at for music, it's a natural thing for me. So yeah, that's my role for Darker Than Wax.
When do you start producing music?
I don't produce, I'm a DJ and selector, so
okay. Yeah. When did you start DJing then?
I started DJing 2000, I had my first gig in 2008. Actually, just a backstory, Olivia is my primary school friend. So, back then, now I'm cool, but back then I was Backstreet Boys and Spice Girls. And I'm like, oh no, she's here. So I started spinning in 2008, and I was.
How do you get into DJing?
How did I get into DJing? First it was Backstreet Boys, Spice Girls, and then I was very into hip hop in the 90s. So I grew up on a mainstream diet, I listened to a lot of the radios of the 90s, and then after that, I discovered drum and bass. Because of clubbing and nightclub, nightlife. So then, yeah, I was pretty much a purist then, so I started playing drum and bass with my friends just at home, chilling out and playing my friends with them. I don't know whether you guys heard of Home Club. So yeah, Home Club used to run practice sessions. It's not a proper night, so maybe weekday evening 7 to 9, they'll let you jam. So you get to do that while being able to afford some shit. So that was my practice. And then first gig in 2008. So yeah.
Maybe you could tell us a little bit about the track you're playing now.
Yeah. So Similar Objects is actually Filipino, and one of the co-founders, Dean Inchu, also half of Costa Nostra, he's the one who's in charge of the A&R announcement when we had like the guest DJ from LA. So she was asking me if we had like a touch of it. Yeah, just like still discovering music and like meeting people and coming here.
Our next candidate is Casey. Welcome. Well, Casey, as we think here, she wanted me to present her as a music lover first. Then from DJ to promoting to booking DJs and starting a company to share what you learned through the years. Very interesting, but I don't quite understand what you mean by starting a company to share what you learned. Well, maybe you can elaborate a little bit more about that.
Okay, so I started an online resource for people called the DJpreneur. So I'm trying to teach other DJs how to make money from DJing.
Very important.
That is an important thing. You know, don't want you to go out there and play gigs for free. You know, yes, you are in the music business, but you're not doing this for free. And it's not just the music business, this is the people business. You need to resonate with people and bring people to you, and that's how you make money. So that's kind of like that in a nutshell. I'll give you a little history about me, where I'm from. I'm originally from Kenosha, Wisconsin. It's about a 1 hour drive when you're driving the speed limit, and you can get to my house from downtown Chicago in about 35 minutes if you drive really fast. And it's about 20 minutes from Milwaukee. So it's like this big hub back in the late 90s where the rave scene started. And I went to my first rave, 8 years older than me, and she took me to an camp out party with her. I thought it was very cool. I had no idea what was going on. I ended up seeing Daft Punk in 1996. I had no idea who they were. I had no idea. You know, I was just trying to be cool with my older sister. Like, so that was my first rave, and I had no idea what it was until I was about like 16 or 17, and it all like came to place. I was like, okay, so this is what it's all about.
When did your first rave before you were 16?
Yeah, I was 13.
Oh.
Yeah. But that happened a lot. There is, it's not all, you know, what the media puts it out to be. It's more like a family gathering and people going out to go with some great music. That's what I'm saying. It's a people business. It's not about music totally. It's about getting together and having a great time with your friends. And so, as I grew up, I kind of resonated even more with Chicago house music and disco and funk, because that's where you know, all my friends were going, and you know, I loved it. I felt this kind of like oneness with people, even though I had no idea who they were. You know, all different races from all different backgrounds, and coming together and staying up all night and sneaking back into the house. So after going to parties, many, many parties, I, you know, befriended a lot of DJs, and I had friends that I lived with, and they would get mad at me because I always told them what to play. Told them what to play, when to play it, and they got fed up, and they're like, screw this, you're gonna learn how to do it. So, it's 19, finally learned how to mix two records together, and it took me about 6 months to actually beat match my very first two records. I don't remember the records. I feel really bad that I don't remember, but it took me 6 months to beat match. And that was back in 2001. And from there, I just was a bedroom DJ for about 5 years until I finally got, you know, the balls to ask my friend if I could come over to her house during after hours and play at a 6 a.m. slot. And then, you know, from there, people are like, hey, she's kind of good, you know? And then, you know, it would go from 6 a.m. slot to doing a 3 a.m. slot, and then from a 3 a.m. slot to a 2 a.m. slot. And then you know, you finally get booked in a real club. So, you know, it took a lot of time and a lot of I think confidence to build it up. And in that time, it wasn't, you know, I'm building a career. It was like I'm hanging out with really cool people that appreciate the same kind of music that I am. And you know, so you know, so grateful that they would, you know, listen to my music and dance all night. And that's another funny story. When I first moved to China back in 2008, I had like my Crater Records. I had my turntables in suitcases. I was overweight, and luckily I flirted with the guy at the counter, and I didn't have to pay for the extra baggage. And I ended up getting a gig like in China, like my first week there, and I show up to the gig with all my vinyl and there's no turntables. This was in 2008. There were I had no idea how to play a CDJ, and they didn't tell me. It was only CDJs. Luckily I had like a stack of like three CDs in my bag, and I ended up playing like off of three CDs the whole time, and they loved it. It was like Chicago House. They weren't really like listening to Chicago House there. The good thing was is I knew how to, like, you know, play beat match and play by ear, and, you know, learning, I just learned on the fly how to do that. So then that night I went home and I just burned a whole bunch of CDs. And when I was in China, I befriended a woman who is, she actually moved to China. She wanted to get out of the US, and she owned a really high profile DJ booking agency, doing mostly hip hop acts, but there were some EDM acts before they were popular that she was bringing out to Asia, like LMFAO was one of the clients that we represented. We also represented DJ Premier. I did his whole tour back in 2010. That came through all of Asia and Australia. So I did all the tour coordination for that. DJ Lord of Public Enemy, DJ Shifty, the DMC world champion. So it's a lot of the hip hop guys. And through that experience working side by side with her, she gave me a lot of, you know, she didn't bullshit me. She always told me like what was up. And, you know, she taught me like the negotiation skills. She also told me how to like stand my own ground, especially as an artist of DJing and going out to clubs. If a venue didn't know about you or you didn't tell them who you were, they would totally brand you in a certain way. Like I would go to a club and they would expect me to like be blonde with boobs hanging out. No, this is how I DJ. I like show up in like, you know, t-shirt, and that's how I go. So working with her actually helped me learn how to be my own person, my own artist, know exactly what I don't want to be and what I don't want to be perceived as. And so taking all of that I've learned from, you know, partying when I was little, doing crazy stuff, and working with this this amazing woman who taught me so much, and working with the artists and their managers directly, taught me a lot of things. And I think a lot of this stuff, I can teach it to people and cut off that learning curve.
That article, that
Walker. He was a producer from, I think, 17 years old, he says. And we met and had beautiful children. And this actually, this track, I think our daughter was maybe like 3 or 4 months old. And it was just a really fun time for us as parents. And we just started like busting out some tracks. And it was the first time we ever collaborated together, and it was really exciting. So it's kind of like deep and dark. And it's funny because I'm really, usually when you hear me out playing, I'm playing like, party time, let's get up. But my husband has that kind of like deeper aspect, and it kind of like, you know, went together when we got together and made this track, which is really, really exciting.
So basically, the contest is just like three songs.
Yeah. So, I guess how I started producing music was when I used to jam rock music with a few of my friends when I was younger. That was, I think, when I was in secondary two, so I was 14 years old then, when I first had my gig. And we did punk rock stuff, you know, those youths in revolt music. And I thought of recording our jamming sessions, and from there I started learning how to use different digital audio workstations. I started with Audacity, if any of y'all know it. It's a very simple wave editing software. Then obviously I went on to better ones. Currently I'm using FL Studio. And when I first learned FL Studio, I actually had to watch this three-part 45-minute video tutorial on YouTube. So I learned it myself, and it wasn't easy, but eventually I managed to make something out of myself. And the very first song that I did was a remix of Emotion Heap's Hide and Seek. Yeah. So I think that was about 2 years ago. So I've been producing for about two and a half years until now. And it wasn't until recently, like I think about half a year ago, when I actually decided to really take things seriously and try to push my music forward a little bit. So what I did was, I actually went to a few producers in Singapore to see if I could get an internship with them. Because at the point of time, I had already graduated from my diploma of Ngee Ann Poly. I studied business, and there was nothing got to do with music. So I thought it was going to be a challenge if I wanted to pursue my career in music. So if I don't use this chance now that I'm doing a vacation, I'm never going to have another chance like this. So finally, I managed to get into contact with this person called Roland Lim. He's the owner of Sing Studios, and he took me in as a sort of apprentice, and I've been learning from him ever since, even now. And I guess that really opened the doors up to a lot more possibilities for me. And I realized something that I had that Roland didn't, is that in his generation, the rock scene was very ongoing in Singapore. There was a lot of producers producing rock bands. And I guess the reason was because there were many people playing rock at that point in time. And the funny thing is that when I came in, the charts in the US were not playing rock anymore. Well, they're still playing rock, but not as much. The focus, I felt, and feel free to disagree, but I felt like it was becoming more electronic. Everything was influenced with electronic sounds. A lot of the new pop songs all contain elements of electronic sounds, and I think that is something we as electronic musicians need to leverage on. And I know there are two few of thoughts in this, and the first being that, you know, electronic music has been around and always will be. And then there's another field of thought which I like to put myself in, and that is that it is really the future of the industry. And for me, I think what I really try to do is think very commercially. And when I make melodies, I always think of what is going to catch the attention of a non-electronic music producer, a non-electronic musician, for example. Because let's be honest here, all the people out there who listen to music, who actually generate the income for us, it's not really the producers, it's not really the musicians, it's really the consumers, and these consumers don't really listen to, don't really know what's going on, but they know what feels good. So on my part, I think a lot of my music is influenced into trying to achieve that. Yeah. Okay, so about my online community that I started, I think it just came very suddenly. one day I just decided that, like, I just felt like I know a few group of people that I found on SoundCloud. I think it was only 12 people.
When was that?
That was about a year ago, year and a half ago.
So this is pretty new.
So I decided to create this online community Facebook group called Singapore Electronic Dance Music Producers, something like that. It was quite a long name, yeah. So basically, the point of it is that people can join the group and share tips on production, because for us electronic musicians, it's not just about making the music, it's also about producing it, mixing it, a lot of studio techniques that all the other genres like rock and jazz won't talk about, won't discuss, like, oh, how much compression for the kick and all that. But only us electronic musicians will actually talk about that. And yeah, it was very technical stuff that I felt when I entered the electronic dance music scene, I didn't have this platform to learn, to meet different people, and I decided to create one because I didn't know of any others at the point in time. Yeah, so, and surprisingly, it grew quite quickly. Locally, I only accept those people who I feel, whom I do like a check and I see, oh yeah, they do actually some serious.
So basically it's a Facebook group, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
And currently it has 137 members. It's a small number, but thinking about what these members actually do, I think it's quite amazing to see that. Well, I didn't expect that it would grow so big in such a short period of time. I thought that, you know, really it's a very rare thing, especially people around my age. And surprisingly, it grew quite big. And from there, I met a few people in real life, and we actually did collaborations, discussed about music and all that. So I think it's our youngest member is actually only Sec 1. He was primary 6 when he joined. So, and I asked him, so how did you start listening to like EDM dance music when you're only like 12 years old? Because I only got into EDM because I got inspired by music from the clubs and all that. And he's only primary school, it's still a far cry away. And he said like he has siblings who listen to it and it just influenced him. And it's quite amazing because he has absolutely zero music theory background, but whatever he feels, he just puts it out into his work. And it's very raw, but you know it's directly from the emotions that he feels. So I think it's quite amazing. Lots of potential.
Maybe you could tell us a little bit more about this track of Mania.
Yes. Okay, so this is the collaboration I did with Gentle Bones. He performed for Music Matters. I'm not sure if you remember him. Yeah. So it's actually not released yet. This is actually a private track. And it will be released on the 30th August. And I got to know him through Roland. We were working. Oh, is it? Oh, I thought it was 39. Okay, sorry. Yeah, I'm going to his EP launch later. Yeah, so. Yes.
So how did this collaboration come about?
So the collaboration came about when Roland, being Gentle Bones' producer, asked me to do a remix for the song. So I agreed, and this is what the result.
Release, one paid release and one free download.
things I would collaborate with promoters, you know, event organizers, so I will, you know, let them listen to my mix, sample. I've been a bit lazy, like, in a sense of, like, I should really actively do up my, you know, like, a mix at least every month, so that people will know, like, oh, what kind of music, you know, issue you're really keeping up with, like, you know, the sounds that's coming up nowadays and all that stuff. So, yeah, I guess it's just mostly for events, I guess, for brands, yeah.
So, in terms of the promotion, you actually do it all yourself, or you have somebody help you?
It's myself, I guess. Like what Philippe said, when it's for myself, I like it better when it's an organic growth. You know, I don't want to like force myself down people's throat. That's not true. I don't want to like, you know, hey, listen to me, you know, it's just like, you know,
common. Like for us, it's the same thing, we don't force it down your throat.
Yeah.
If you like it, you like it. If you don't like it, we're not going to force you.
Yeah.
But how do you actually get people to listen to it in the first place?
Actually, it depends, because like I mentioned, like Pala Digital is not commercial EDM. We represent the alternative electronic music. So we have a group of people who listen to alternative music. So in a way, it's the same group of people. And our biggest challenge is to kind of expand it. And it's not just EDM anymore. There's also, it's like rock and roll music. There's subgenres, there's genres and all that stuff. So it's the same thing with EDM music as well. So yeah, it really depends. But we don't force it down the throat. I mean, it's a matter of how you educate yourself and what you want to listen to. Because like, what I listen to will be different from what I listened to 5 years ago. What I play out today will be different from what I play out 5 years ago. So in a way, it's like, it kind of, your maturity actually plays a part in the type of music you listen to. So, you know, that actually changes over time.
So what kind of interesting collaborations have you done?
Besides Pala Nishuka, I'm also a co-founder for Edigo, which is like, in a way, Edigo is like a music label. It's like, especially for girls. And, you know, we give them place, gigs to play out. And right now, we're still kind of like, still growing our brand, where in a sense where, you know, we want to reach out not to just music, in arts as well, in visual arts. Because in my day job, I do, since I work in an exhibition, I work in CCA, Centre for Contemporary Art Singapore. And so I think right now in this current state, there is a lot of integration in music and visual arts as well. I mean, one very good example is CBK. Like, if you can see the shows, there's always like visual elements in it.
Just working with these visual artists as well. That's the type of collaboration that you get.
I'll share like a. It's not really a collaboration. We had our one release on a label, and we really didn't take action in terms of finding the bloggers, finding the websites to do our PR for us, and we kind of just like let it release and hope for the best. It really didn't do that well on that label. And then, three or something months after the release came, a friend of ours asked to re-release it on a compilation CD, or in the a DJ Kicks mix. So it was the DJ Kicks mix that was released in February of this year. They asked us in last, I think it was August. Okay, so from that time frame, from August all the way up to the release of the Kicks mix, there was promotion. There was, we had so many different reviews on different blogs and websites. And the way that label did it is they actually hired out a different PR agency. But we also put a fire under our butts and reached out to different music journalists to get our stuff featured. And that's kind of like how I started like learning a little bit more, and that's how I became like a music journalist myself, or I write for 10 different websites now. And it's just meeting different people that write articles for different music. people thought it was really good music, but nobody took responsibility to actually get it, get reviews, or put it under people's nose to, and it wasn't saying, we weren't saying like, here, look at us, look at us. It was, you know, first make that, establish that connection with whoever's writing for a different website, or whoever has like a large mailing list, or artists that you align yourself with that are actually bloggers as well, because there's a lot of electronic music musicians are actually bloggers, and they will feature content on their websites or feature it on their YouTube channel or something like that. So it's very important if you have a release coming up, you know, like for you, when you just say at the end of the year,
beginning of next year.
So right now is the time to start planning, and you can actually start giving them, you know, like promos and stuff once you have it, that created. And it's I'm only saying this because I experienced it myself, and I've experienced it in both ways with the same release, the same song. So it's nice to have like a really big group, you know, re-release it, but it kind of helped us realize like what we need to do for our next release is actually, you know, if you get signed to a label, you can't say, oh, they're going to do a promotion for you to get to sell those records. Yeah, they want to sell records, but you know, they'll have other releases going on as well. You need to put the effort into it as well to get the exposure that you really want. So I think that's a part of the collaboration part that a lot of people fall flat is the work doesn't stop there. It doesn't stop when the music is done, when the last beat is mastered. You know, the collaboration keeps going before the release is coming out and when the release is coming out. You know, maybe even you know, a couple years down the line. Hey, remember we did that release? Let's do a party. You know, it's a partnership. It's not just a handshake, you know, passing by. It's something that is more substantial than that. And I think that's what the piece that we need to
understand. I think that's a very good point. Because how many of us, especially those who are producers or artists themselves, when you put out your own music, or when you are making your own music, you have a deadline, you have something that you want it to be out by, say, this year or next year whatsoever. How many of you actually plan how you're going to promote it at the same time? Maybe just a raise of hands, get to a poll here, like if you are a musician, you're an artist, right? How many actually think about the planning portion about promoting your music?
I don't know.
How many of you actually don't? I mean, you can be honest. Yeah. How many don't? Well, of those who don't, right, is it because you don't know how to, or is it because you don't care? Or both?
You ask.
Yes.
Okay,
who
doesn't
care? who cares, but you don't have the expertise, or you don't know where to start? Who faces that problem?
Who would like to know?
I'll just say from personal experience, for me, it's like, I just didn't understand. I didn't understand the whole process behind it. You know, if I would have known, yeah, I would have put more effort into it. And it's just that's part of the industry that isn't really well known. You know, but that's why I say it's a people business. You need to be like.
Maybe you could share some tips, like you know, how can, well, what should they keep in mind?
So for a lot of the people that I contacted to like do a review for the second release, I found that I would look at different websites and see, you know, who is the author of that article or that review. And most times they'll have like a Twitter handle. And so I'll like, you know, I'll add them or, you know, comment something nice and just keep on making sure like daily I'll shoot out something nice. And I'll follow their blog, and so whenever they post something on their blog or their website, it'll come to me, and then I make sure I, you know, either comment or I say something nice on Twitter, figure out where your music aligns with. Find those like websites that are kind of, you know, in that niche that would might feature you. Find out who the art, who the authors are, maintain and start relationships with them. More often than that, not there's some like low key, like there's like high end websites like DJ Mag or, you know, all them, and then there's like lower tier ones. And some of those lower tier ones, you could just say like, hey, I want to write for you, and just like, you know, write your own stuff. And that's like a piece of the pie that a lot of people don't realize. So it's kind of cool when you get your stuff featured, because that's where you have content into your social media, and it's not you telling people that you're awesome. Other people get talked about.
Yeah, I see Jesus nodding.
Yeah.
Because before I started, you know, like producing, I was actually manning this website called Breaking Asia. So I did a lot of like video interviews of artists, of producers, and also I write music videos. I did a lot of the back end work. I also did music videos as well for the artists. Can you guys hear me? Right. So I did all this back end work. So that's why I totally can relate to what she was saying. So it's not, I realized that too many guys, especially because like when I first started DJing, it's almost like mostly guys. So what they did is they are very good DJs, they are very good producers, but they tend to do their work and then they just leave it to the admin, you know, which is usually their girlfriend or maybe, you know.
Yeah.
No, I'm serious, they're very bad at, you know, like admin work. And they are very lucky, they have their girlfriend or their wife to do it all for them, you know, then their work get, you know, like out. But most of them, you know, they just do their work and then that's it, you know, like they put it there all. Even now, some of them, they just put it up on SoundCloud and expect their friends to listen to it. So that is totally, you know, like not working at all. So on my side, what I did is I joined Communal Music Making Group, like Inspired Jundo, which is an experimental music making group. And I also joined Midnight Oi, which is a 1 minute beat making group. So these are the niche groups which you should target at, you know, depending on whether you're doing EDM or, you know, like rock or band music. You target at all these niche music making group. You know, like if they have like a remix, you know, open up for people to do it, go and do it. You know? You know, you might, your remixes might get noticed, and then they will, you know, listen to your other music. Or if they have some activities or, you know, anything, you know, just help them out. You know, comment on their events or their music. So in return, they will listen to you as well. So all this back end work, you have to do it. But I have to admit, it does take a lot of time.
Okay, I'm not so experienced in this field, but I know personally two people who have became pretty big by winning remix competitions. And yeah, because Spinning Records and the label owned by Steve Aoki, what was it, I forgot about it. Yeah, Dimmark Records, they normally regularly hold remix competitions, and I'm not a big fan of it because I think a lot of it lies in the individual popularity of the producer even before he actually submits a track. But I think one of the important things that you must know is that in the first place, when you release the song, do people like it? I think that's something we must consider when we are actually producing the music or writing the music. And okay, I just share a personal experience of mine. I did a remix of John Legend's All of Me, and because it was an unofficial remix, like there was no acapella release, I took the MP3, I cut up the lows, I made my own bass and everything, added my own kicks, created a new drop for the song, and I just posted it on SoundCloud. I didn't do anything to it, I didn't expect anything from it, but it got picked up by this website. I think it was called Fist in the Air, and it was featured, and the next thing I know, my SoundCloud followers more than doubled, and like
I got like 63,000 hits on the song. So it's quite amazing, yeah. It's, and I didn't even know, and even up to now, I don't really understand what's happening. I tried to look at the SoundCloud statistics, you know, if you are a pro account user. Yeah, and there's a point in time I was getting 2,000 hits a day. I didn't understand where people were getting the hits from. I tried to find where the website, possibly which website was the one that was linking the song that was getting all the hits, and turns out that I needed to get like a premium account, which is even higher than pro, to actually find out. Yeah, so I didn't. So yeah, but I believe it was from Fist in the Air that I think it got picked up. And how it got picked up, I have no idea. But I know even in my group, a lot of them, we always tell them, if you really want your songs to get heard, you got to actively, constantly come up with consistent tracks and send them to promoters. Because on YouTube, there's a lot of promoters like Proximity and all these things. And these people, they will just take up tracks and you don't have to pay a single cent. So, I mean, based on what the description says, they promise they'll listen to every single track. And anyway, there's no harm trying. Normally, I have a list of email addresses that I keep. That if I come up with something new, I'll always make sure these people get to hear them. And once people actually like it, and if it gets shared, right, actually, I think it's like, it will just spread like wildfire. So, yeah.